Receive fresh unction this morning. Lift up your voice. Let God hear your voice. Make it louder unto the Lord. Lord, I receive fresh unction, fresh word, fresh unction. Lift up your voice unto the Lord. Make your voice louder a little bit for God. Lift up your voice. I receive fresh unction, fresh unction. Lord, speak your word unto me this morning. Speak your word unto me this morning. Speak your word unto me this morning. Let him hear your voice, your word of life, your word of healing, your word of favor, your word of deliverance. Speak unto me this morning. Speak unto me this morning. Your word. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Somebody ready to receive God's word this morning, shout aloud, glory. Come on, shout it louder, glory. Please put your hands together for Jesus. You may be comfortably seated in God's presence. Hallelujah. This morning is my great privilege to bring the word unto us in this service. And I trust that the Holy Ghost will walk a strange walk in your life in the name of Jesus. In the first service, we had an explosive time with the word. I'd like to encourage you to get the teaching CDs of that service. It will change something inside of you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Our prophetic word for this month is exploit is my birthright in Christ. Can you say that to yourself? Make it louder a little bit. Now say it to your neighbor. Exploit is my birthright in Christ. And our teaching series for our Sunday services is understanding the master key to a world of exploits. Understanding the master key to a world of exploit. I'm taking part 3B in this service. I like to remind us that every child of God is ordained for a life of exploit. Not shame, not mediocrity, but a life of exploit. In Daniel chapter 11 and verse 32, Daniel 11:32, the Bible says, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God, they shall be strong and do exploits. The people who do know their God, your God is not a failure God. Your God is not a mediocre God. Your God is a God of exploits. And when they saw the kind of wisdom that was demonstrated in the life of Jesus, he said, what kind of wisdom is this with these mighty works? Matthew chapter 13 and verse 54. Mighty works, not just ordinary works. Where comes this kind of wisdom and these mighty works? So your God is a worker of mighty works. So also in your life, you are not expected to generate anything less than mighty works. In your businesses, mighty works. In your family, mighty works. In your career, mighty works. In your academics, mighty works. Not let my people go. You know, some students read for let my people go. Let me just pass. That's not where you belong. You belong to the realm of the distinguished. You belong to the realm of the first class. Mighty works. Jesus says, the work that I do, you shall do. Greater works than this shall you do. John chapter 14 and verse 12. John chapter 14 and verse 12. Greater works than this shall you do, because I go unto my Father. And what are the kinds of work he did? Mighty works. So if he did mighty works, you will not only do mighty works, you can do mightier works. Praise the name of the Lord. Life in Christ is a life of exploits. Not average, not shame. And that's why I know this morning, every issue of shame in your life shall be rolled away.
By this anointing, whatever issue in your life that people look at you and ask you, where is your God? Today, it shall be rolled away in the name of Jesus. The Bible talks about a man called Naaman in 2 Kings chapter 5. You know the story too well. 2 Kings chapter 5. He had exploit in so many areas. He was a warrior. He was a captain of the army of Syria. Through his hands, great things were done. But the Bible says, but he was a leper. Every other side was good. But there is one aspect of shame. Leprosy connotes shame. I don't know how much God has done in your life, but there may be one area of your life. Every day you look unto God and say, God, if only you can do this. If only you can open this door. If only this shame can be rolled away from my life. I prophesy to you this morning, by the word of God, that issue of shame shall be rolled away in the name of Jesus. He said, for it shall come to pass in that day, the burden shall be taken away from your shoulders and the yoke off your neck, and it shall be destroyed by reason of the anointing. Every satanic yoke that have been hanging around your life, that have been hanging in your generation, that have been hanging in your career, today, by the anointing, it shall be destroyed in the name of Jesus. What is exploit? Exploit is my birthright. What is exploit? Number one, exploit implies outstanding results. Outstanding results. Outstanding results. If you are a child of God, you are meant to be outstanding in every area of your life. And to be outstanding simply means to stand out. You are not on the same line with others. There is something in your life that is expected to bring you out, to stand out, to stand out. Until the result that is generated in your life catches the attention of people, it is not yet outstanding. After this anointing, God is giving you a result that will draw attention to you. That amen is not weak. That amen is too weak for a miracle. What is exploit? Number two, it means record-breaking accomplishment. Record-breaking accomplishment. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it come into the heart of man. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verses 9 and 10. The things that God has prepared for them that love him. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, record-breaking accomplishment. Things that have not been known to happen in your career, it will happen with you in the name of Jesus. The kind of result that has never been generated in that place of work where God has placed you, it will begin with you in the name of Jesus. The places that nobody has stepped in your family for good, you are stepping there after this service. In the name of Jesus. Record-breaking accomplishment. You are ordained for that level of exploit, that level of accomplishment. You are not ordained for normal results. Because you are supernatural. You are not normal. You are supernatural. You are not ordinary. You are extraordinary. He that cometh from above is above all. Matthew chapter 5 and verses 13 to 15. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. You are like a city that is set on a hill. Matthew 5, 13 to 15. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden. That cannot be hidden. Even if you want to hide, after this anointing, it will be impossible for you. I say it will be impossible for you. I say it will be impossible for you. This anointing will make you stand out. I said this anointing will make you stand out. After this service, the kind of result that will generate, it will bring tears of joy to your faces. It will bring tears of joy to your faces. In the name of Jesus. Record-breaking accomplishment. Look at the life of Isaac. In Genesis chapter 26 and verse 13, the Bible says, Genesis 26 and verse 13, and this man was great. We are not talking about another man. This man that everybody thought cannot succeed. This man that everybody has rejected. This man that everybody has given up on. This same man, he was great. He went forward. He grew until he became very great. I guess that is your description. I say, I guess that is your description. I guess that is your description. In the name of Jesus. Record-breaking accomplishment. What of Job? Job became the greatest in the East. Job chapter 1 verse 3. He became the greatest. He became the greatest. Maybe in your family, nobody ever goes up. When they are about to go up, they bring them down. Not you. Not you. Not you. Not you. After this anointing, that yoke shall be destroyed in your family. That yoke shall be destroyed in your family. Maybe nobody has ever built any house in your family. Each time they are trying to build, they kill them. Maybe there was a building that your fathers have started 30 years ago up to now, yet uncompleted because of the works of wicked men. But I speak to you by the anointing of God today, that yoke shall be destroyed. That yoke shall be destroyed. That yoke shall be destroyed. He became the greatest man in the East. The greatest man in the East. That's exploits. That's the realm you belong to. And from the beginning of this year, it has been declared to the winner's family that giants shall rise. Giant in every field of life. That word has gone forth. It cannot return unto him void. No matter the position where you are now, it does not take God time. If you believe his word, if you believe his word, before this year is over, that testimony shall become a reality in your life. That testimony shall become a reality in your life. In the name of Jesus. Where you are is already tired of you. You are going forward. In Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse 3. Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse 3. Ye have compassed this mountain long enough. Turn, you not war. You have compassed this mountain enough. Turn, 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 turn. There is a force of the spirit that will forcefully change your position. Turn, you have compassed this mountain long enough. Long enough, the forces of hell have held you down long enough. The forces of barrenness has held you down long enough. The forces of stagnation has held you down long enough. Turn. That doesn't look like an admonishment. It looks like a commandment. Turn. Turn. It's not an advice. Turn. By the force of the spirit today, something is turning inside of you. Something is turning inside of you. Maybe they have tied down your destiny somewhere. They say you will not marry. They say you will not be promoted. They say you will not go forward. I speak by the Spirit of God, by the unction back in this commission, that snare is destroyed. That snare is destroyed. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. God wants every area of your life to be a positive reference and not a reproach. God wants every area of your life to be a positive reference, not a reproach. He said, and men shall see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Men shall see your good works. You have spoken enough. They want to see the reality. And give glory to your Father that is in heaven. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16. God wants every area of your life to be a positive reference. In Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 15. Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 15. Whereas thou hast been forsaken and hated, so that no man went through thee, I will make thee an eternal excellency, a joy of many generations. Men may have mocked you, but God can make you. I will make you an eternal excellency. That word excellency is honorable. A joy of many generations. Maybe you have been a concern to your family. Maybe you have been a concern to people around you. And each time they see you coming, they shake their head. They shake their head. But not after this service. Not after this service. After this service, there's going to be a forceful turnaround. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In Revelation chapter 5 and verse 10, he has made us unto kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. We are expected to reign in any domain we are positioned in life. We are supposed to have continuous breakthroughs in every area of life. But unfortunately, many that are ordained to live as kings and priests, they are living as slaves. It's an error under the sun. It's an error under the sun. So that's why you need a superior force. Because you have been held captive, not by your own doing, not willingness, but the forces of hell is holding you down. That's why you need a force, a superior force from heaven. Many want to go forward. Many want to succeed, but they don't know the key. When you have the key, you don't struggle. When you have the key, you don't struggle. No matter how physically strong you are, if you don't have the key to a door, you will struggle. You will sweat. And only the one that have the key has control, has access. His weight notwithstanding. If you don't have the key, your weight, you can be big, you can be muscular, but the door will not respect you. But the one who has the key, it may just be a small boy. He just walks in with the key very quietly and opens without struggle. It is the key that gives you authority. It is the key that gives you dominion. It is the key that gives you access. When you have the key, no devil can resist you. When you have the key, you don't negotiate. When you have the key, you take control. Hallelujah. What is therefore the master key to a life of exploits? Matthew 22, verses 36 to 40. What is the master key to a life of exploits? Matthew 22 and verses 36 to 40. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Love is the master key to a life of exploits. Love. Love is the master key to a life of exploits. If you see a master key, it's not in the size. A master key is just a tiny instrument that has the ability to open any door, anytime, at will. When you have the master key, you have the power, you have the authority to take what you desire anytime. The master key, it opens any kind of door. That's why it is called master. It has dominion over every door. The moment you stretch out the key, the door will say, I hear, sir, and open. That's why it's a master key. You use that key, barrenness will look at, as soon as barrenness sees the key, he says, sorry. You approach the door of promotion with that key. As soon as the door sees the key and say, oh, sorry, we have been waiting for you. That's why it's a master key. It's the master of every situation and circumstances of life. Love is that master key. It may look small, but it is powerful. It is the love of God in the heart of man. that throws him into a life of all-round exploits. Love. Love. The deeper your love for God is, the higher you rise in life. In Psalm 91 and verse 14. Psalm 91 and verse 14. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. Because he has set his love upon me, not upon things, not upon title, not upon persons, but he has set his love upon me. I am committed. I will set him on high above all. I will set him. He wouldn't need to beg me. He wouldn't need to ask me. Because he has set his love upon me, it's conditional. When you do it, it becomes automatic. The deeper your love for God, the higher you rise in life. It is your level of love, the intensity of your love for God, that determines the quality of your life. Not the economic situation. Not the situation and circumstances around you. No, it is your love for God. Your love for God. Your love for God. Your love for God. God can do anything for lovers. I have not seen. Ears have not heard. Neither has he come into the heart of man. The things that God has prepared for them that love him. 1 Corinthians 2:9. For them that love him. Not for everybody that comes to church. Not for everybody that has a sticker. Not for everybody that chants from glory to glory. For them that love him. For them that love him. Not for everyone that is in 2-3 units in the church. You can be full of activities and yet not love God. For them that love him. For them that love him. You can be high, you can be carrying a title and yet not love him. There is no entitlement in title. For them that love him, do you love God? Your position in life is determined by your sincere answer to that question. Do you love God? Your heart is what God wants. He said, my son, give me your heart. Proverbs 23 and verse 26. Give me your heart. I need your heart. Your heart is divided. Give me your heart. It's either I am the Lord of all or I am the Lord of none. Give me all your heart. Give me all your heart. David became a darling of God. Why? Because he gave God all his heart. He was a man after God's heart. His heart was beating after the things that was beating in the heart of God. What is beating in your heart? Give me your heart. Give me your heart and I will give you the earth. Give me your heart and I will give you the earth. Give me your heart and I will give you the heart. The position you give God in your heart is what determines the position he gives you on the earth. The position you give God in your heart is what determines the position he places you on the earth. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. Seek ye first. What position is God in your heart? First or second or last? Give me your heart. Love is just more than singing. It's just more than jumping. No, it is a practical demonstration to the advancement of God's kingdom. God's servant, our father in faith, Bishop David Oyedepo said, you don't know my secret until you know my heart for God. That is where my secret is, my heart. Everything is sold out to God. I have no reservation. I don't feel for myself. Where is your heart? Your heart is what determines your path. You have prayed enough. Walk yourself into your testimony. By a practical demonstration of love for God. Your heart is what determines your path. If your heart is there for God, nothing moves you. You are completely sold out. Nothing can stop you. If your heart is for God, nothing, no discouragement, nothing. Hear what Paul says. In Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. He said, none of these things move me. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I've received of the Lord to testify the gospel of the grace of God. None of these things move me. When you see a Christian who is moved by every little thing, you see, I don't think I will come to church again. The way the usher treated me, he just took my Bible from that seat. He hold me. And that has affected your services to God. You don't love God. You have left that evangelism group. Why? Because of the way somebody spoke to you. It wasn't God you came to seek after. You came to seek for man. When you are moved by little things, small things, where you sit, who greets you, who didn't greet you, whether you are ordained or not, you see, I came to this church before those people they ordained. I don't know how they do this thing here. One of them was my convert. I preached to him. I followed him up. And now they say he's a deacon. Me, they left me. Okay, they won't see me. They don't understand my value. They don't know the anointing I carry. Paul said, none of these things move me. None of these things move me. You came for evangelism, and suddenly your car broke down. And since then, your zeal for God has dwindled. Who gave you the car? Thank God. Is it not God that didn't allow your life to break down? None of these things move me. I count my life as nothing. In Romans chapter 5 and verses 35 to 38. Romans chapter 8 verses 35 to 38. Romans 8, 35 to 38. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor power, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Hallelujah. If you check men of exploit in scriptures, this was their fundamental secret, the love for God. David, a lover of God, in 1 Samuel chapter 13 and verse 14. He was a man after God's heart, 1 Samuel 13, 14. Job was a man that feared God. The things of God mattered to him, so he became the greatest man in the East. Job chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. Job 1, verses 1 to 3. Daniel was a man that loved God. He would not defile himself. In Daniel chapter 1 and verse 8, with the king's meal, he refused, I'm not going to defile myself. He stood for God. He loved God. And we saw how he was lifted in the land. Paul was a lover of God. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21. He said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. He was sold out. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. The life I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Love was their fundamental secret. And we saw all the exploit they generated. You too will generate exploits in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. What is in the power? What is the power of love? Let's look at the power of love. Number one, what power is in love? Number one, love is failure proof. It's a failure proof force. It's a failure proof force. You don't fail loving God. You don't fail loving God, because God, there is no failure in God. And if you are in God, you are in love. When you are in love, you are in God. God is not a failure. You cannot fail. Love cannot fail. Faith can fail. Prayer may fail, but love will never fail. God is not looking for the strong. He's only looking for the faithful. So faithfully go after him. And every door that you expect to open will open in your life. Hallelujah. Love is failure-proof force. Every other thing may fail. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 8. Every other thing may fail, but love can never fail. Charity never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. Any other thing can fail, but love can never fail, because God is love. He that loves is in God, and God is in him. Number two, love engenders supernatural breakthroughs. Love engenders supernatural breakthroughs. In Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verses 1 to 2. Deuteronomy 28 and verses 1 to 2. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord your God, to observe and to do all his commandments which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all the nations of the earth. Above all. Love takes people above. It doesn't take people down. Love takes people forward. It doesn't take people backward. If you will hearken diligently, if you will seek God, if you will run after God with your whole heart, he said, I will set you above. I will open every closed doors. So love engenders supernatural breakthrough. And number three, love makes all true lovers of Christ indestructible. It makes all true lovers of Christ indestructible. Indestructible. You can't be touched. You can't be killed. You can't be harmed. Hallelujah. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, the Bible says, you are of God, little children, and overcome them. Why? Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So if you are in love with God, God resides in you. Whatever cannot touch God cannot touch you. Whatever cannot harm God cannot harm you. No satanic arrow of the devil can touch God. Your life is hid in Christ and Christ in God. So if you walk in love, if you love God, you are shielded, you are protected. They threw those three Hebrew brothers into fire. They couldn't burn. Why? Because God was there with them, the fourth man. So when you are living a life of love for God, anywhere you go, you carry God. God's presence goes with you everywhere. God's presence goes with you everywhere. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He anointed me even in the presence of my enemies. My cup runneth over. They were helpless. So when you are walking in love, your enemies become helpless. You can't stop them from planning. You can't stop them from gathering. The Bible says, surely they shall gather. You can't stop them even from taking counsel. They will take counsel. But he said, their counsel will be nothing. I will destroy their counsel. I will destroy. I will break their plans. So when you walk in love, you are shielded. No devil can touch you. What are the biblical proofs of love? How do I know I love God? How do I know I love God? If you love God, you will give to his cause. If you love God, you will give. You will give. You will give. You will give. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. If you love God, you will give. If you love God, the grace to give becomes easy. You give easily to the advancement of God's kingdom. True love is demonstrated by giving. Is demonstrated by giving. Everyone in scripture that love God, they prove they love God by giving. Solomon loved the Lord and he gave. 1 Kings chapter 3 verse 3. David loved the Lord, he gave. Because I've set my affection on God. He demonstrated it by giving qualitatively. He demonstrated it by giving qualitatively unto the Lord. If you love God, you will give. True lovers are givers. True lovers are givers. And that's why when you see a man who has just located somebody to marry, the love is turning him from head to toe. Nothing can stop him to demonstrate his love. He has gone to visit his wife-to-be. And the only money he had in his pocket is the one to transport him back. As he gets there after talking and talking, and she's escorting him. And suddenly, The sister say, oh, I like some ice cream. He say, okay, ice cream, no problem. She takes the first one. The transport money has reduced. The sister say, and I like the other one, the brown one. She takes again. The money keeps reducing until the money finishes. It's not disturbed. You can just feel free. Take it. Take it. Take it. No problem. He will even ask more, do you want more? And be praying silently, oh God, let her say no. And as soon as the sister leaves him and he's going from Goshen, maybe to Asokoro. So as soon as the sister leaves him, he's excited, he has given to his lover. So he rolls his trousers and says, Lord, thank you for strength. And begins to march on. Why? Because he met his lover. If you love God, you will give. You will give. Praise the name of the Lord. You will give. Number two, if you love God, you will love his house. If you love God, you will love his house. Psalm 122, verses 1 to 6. I was glad when they said unto me, David said, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad. Coming to a church will be delight for you. You won't grumble. You won't murmur. You won't murmur. If you love God, you will love his house. You will be desiring every service, every program. You will be desiring. You will want to be in his presence. Why? Because Zion is the dwelling place of God. Why must you love Zion? It's the dwelling place of God. God resides there. God stays there. That is his habitation. In Psalm 132 and verses 13 to 14. For the Lord has chosen Zion. Psalm 132 verses 13 and 14. For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his habitation. This is my rest forever. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless her provision. I will satisfy her poor with bread. I will also clothe her priests with salvation. And her saints shall shout aloud with joy. Zion is God's habitation. And there is no safer place than where God dwells. There is no safer place than where God dwells. He said, I will clothe her. I will satisfy her. That's the place of your satisfaction. There is nothing that you desire that is not in Zion. There is nothing you desire that is not in Zion. So we don't come to church just to fulfill all righteousness. We don't just come to church. Church is not a social place. Church is a spiritual place. It's a place of encounter with the living God. Where God satisfies your need. Instead of looking unto man to meet your need, look unto God. So in Zion, that is where God satisfies your needs. That's why you have countless testimonies. People say, as I started coming to the church, suddenly this door opened. As I started coming to the church, this affliction of my life, my long-standing affliction, vanished. That is where God dwells. And no evil is permitted to dwell there. Praise the name of the Lord. No evil is permitted to dwell there. You remember that leper by the beautiful gate? Peter and John got there. They say, what is this ugly situation doing at the feet of the beautiful gate? Say, arise, you are not permitted. Everything here in Zion is beautiful. Your situation will not remain in the name of Jesus. It is the dwelling place of God. It is a place of strength. Psalm 84 verse 7. They go from strength to strength as many that are in Zion. Psalm 84 and verse 7. They go from strength to strength as many that appeared before God in Zion. So Zion is a place of strength. People who come to church regularly, they never get weak. It's a place of strength. It's a place of strength. It's a place of strength. Zion is a place of deliverance. Obadiah 1 and verse 17. Upon Mount Zion there shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness. And the sons of Jacob shall possess their possession. It's a place of deliverance. It's a place of deliverance. That sister said, with the issue of blood, all these years, I've been carrying that plague. But they told me, 3 months, if you still have this plague, don't come to church. She said, for many years, you say 3 months, okay, let's go. She came and God visited her. Why? Because it is a place of deliverance. It is a place of deliverance. Do you have some affliction in your life that have defied all kinds of solutions? Stay in Zion. Satan will fight by all means to take you out of Zion, because he wants to stop your miracle. He knows when he takes you out of your covering zone, he has right to afflict you, just like that prodigal son. Until he left his father's house, Satan could not touch him. Stay, because Zion is a place of deliverance. And lastly, it is a place where you possess your possession. Where you possess your possession. Whatever it is that Jesus has paid the price with his blood is available. You possess it in Zion. You possess it in Zion. You possess it in Zion. And thank God you are in Zion this morning. Thank God it's an anointing service. In Isaiah chapter 10 and verse 27, it shall come to pass in that day. The burden shall be taken away from your shoulders. All the problems, the challenges, and the yoke from your neck. And it shall be destroyed by reason of the anointing. Whatever plague, whatever challenge that you came therefore with this morning, it shall be destroyed in the name of Jesus. May the Lord give you understanding in Jesus' mighty name. Just before we rise up to pray, one major requirement for your liberty today is you must be born again. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 3, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great way of salvation? How will you escape from that struggle? How will you escape from that trap of satanic manipulation? How will you escape from that spirit of death that have been roving over your family? If you say no to Jesus today, you have said no to life. If you say no to Jesus today, you have said yes to afflictions and sorrows. But I know somebody will say yes to Jesus today. Maybe you gave your life to Jesus before you backslided. Today, his hands are wide open. He can receive you, and your life will never be the same. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I know as I'm speaking now, somebody is saying, I need to give my life to Jesus now. I know something has gone wrong in my life. This way I'm living, I am not sure of eternity. This way I'm going, I live in fear. But Jesus is here today. I want to introduce you to that Jesus. If you will only say yes, things will change. Things will turn around. Maybe you gave your life before, you backslided because you are pursuing after job. You are pursuing after marriage. Satan took you. And since then, things have been going down. You can return today and he will accept you. I know somebody is ready to do that. Now, wherever you are, you want to say yes to Jesus. I'd like you to rise up on your feet wherever you are. Rise up on your feet wherever you are. I know as I'm speaking now, something is telling you, it is me, it is me, it is me. The Spirit of God is convicting your heart. Forget about your neighbor. Rise up on your feet. Take that bold step. Today is a day of turnaround. Wherever you are giving your life to Jesus, or maybe you are rededicating your life to Jesus. Rise up on your feet. You know you are very zealous for God before, but you backslided. You can return to Jesus. Rise up and join them. Rise up and join them. No matter how far you have gone, you can return to Jesus. No matter how far you have gone, you can return to Jesus. Rise up. All those rising up, please, can I ask you to take your Bible and come forward wherever you came with. Come forward. God bless you. Come forward quickly. Quickly, wherever you are, come forward. If I were you, I would start running from where I am. The faster you get to the front, the faster your miracle arrives. Come quickly, come quickly. God bless you. Come quickly from wherever you are. Don't say no to him this morning. Don't say no to him this morning. That's where your salvation is. That's where your healing is. That's where your deliverance is. Let's celebrate them, church. Come quickly, come quickly. Wherever you are, don't say no to Jesus. To reject him is to reject life. Wherever you are, come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. God bless you. Come quickly. God bless you. Come quickly. We are waiting for you. I know there are some people that are seated there. You are still saying, should I go? Should I not go? That's the devil making you to think that way. Break that yoke. Rise up from your feet and begin to come forward. God bless you. Come quickly. Come quickly. Please join us quickly. All those in front, I'd like to congratulate you for this step you have taken. Every one of us took this step one day. And since we took this step, our lives never remained the same. This seemingly simple step you have taken today is going to bring a holistic turnaround in every area of your life. In the name of Jesus. Not just giving your life to Jesus. Stay in Zion. Stay in Zion. You heard the testimony of that sister. They say stay 3 months and you will see God's visitation. If you can stay 3 months, consistently hearing God's word and taking practical steps of obedience, you must have your testimony in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I'd like you to bow your head. Bow your head. Bow your head. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you this morning. I realize I'm a sinner, but you died for me. You took away my sin. You redeemed me with your blood. My heart is open this morning. I believe in my heart, Jesus, and I confess you with my mouth. Be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for receiving me. Because I've confessed you, I know I am born again. Thank you for receiving me. In Jesus' mighty name. Father, thank you for these precious souls that you have redeemed this day. No one comes to you except you draw them. You have drawn them, preserve them, keep them. Let none of them be lost. In the name of you, fresh unction this morning. Lift up your voice. Let God hear your voice. Make it louder unto the Lord. Lord, I receive fresh unction, fresh word, fresh unction. Lift up your voice unto the Lord. Make your voice louder a little bit for God. Lift up your voice. I receive fresh unction, fresh unction. Lord, speak your word unto me this morning. Speak your word unto me this morning. Speak your word unto me this morning. Let him hear your voice, your word of life, your word of healing, your word of favor, your word of deliverance. Speak unto me this morning. Speak unto me this morning. Your word. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Somebody ready to receive God's word this morning? Shout aloud, glory. Come on, shout it louder, glory. Please put your hands together for Jesus. You may be comfortably seated in God's presence. Hallelujah. This morning is my great privilege to bring the word unto us in this service. And I trust that the Holy Ghost will walk a strange walk in your life in the name of Jesus. In the first service, we had an explosive time with the word. I'd like to encourage you to get the teaching CDs of that service. It will change something inside of you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Our prophetic word for this month is exploit is my birthright in Christ. Can you say that to yourself? Make it louder a little bit. Now say to your neighbor, exploit is my birthright in Christ. And our teaching series for our Sunday services is understanding the master key to a world of exploits. Understanding the master key to a world of exploit. I'm taking part 3B in this service. I like to remind us that every child of God is ordained for a life of exploit. Not shame, not mediocrity, but a life of exploit. In Daniel chapter 11 and verse 32, Daniel 11:32, the Bible says, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God, they shall be strong and do exploits. The people who do know their God. Your God is not a failure God. Your God is not a mediocre God. Your God is a God of exploits. And when they saw the kind of wisdom that was demonstrated in the life of Jesus, he said, what kind of wisdom is this with these mighty works? Matthew chapter 13 and verse 54. Mighty works. Not just ordinary works. Where comes this kind of wisdom and these mighty works? So your God is a worker of mighty works. So also in your life, you are not expected to generate anything less than mighty works. In your businesses, mighty works. In your family, mighty works. In your career, mighty works. In your academics, mighty works. Not let my people go. You know, some students read for let my people go. Let me just pass. That's not where you belong. You belong to the realm of the distinguished. You belong to the realm of the first class. Mighty works. Jesus says, the work that I do, you shall do. Greater works than this shall you do. John chapter 14 and verse 12. John chapter 14 and verse 12. Greater works than this shall you do, because I go unto my Father. And what are the kinds of work he did? Mighty works. So if he did mighty works, you will not only do mighty works, you can do mightier works. Praise the name of the Lord. Life in Christ is a life of exploits, not average, not shame. And that's why I know this morning, every issue of shame in your life shall be rolled away. By this anointing, whatever issue in your life that people look at you and ask you, where is your God? Today, it shall be rolled away in the name of Jesus. The Bible talks about a man called Naaman in 2 Kings chapter 5. You know the story too well. 2 Kings chapter 5. He had exploits in so many areas. He was a warrior. He was the captain of the army of Syria. Through his hands, great things were done. But the Bible says, but he was a leper. Every other side was good. But there is one aspect of shame. Leprosy connotes shame. I don't know how much God has done in your life, but there may be one area of your life. Every day you look unto God and say, God, if only you can do this. If only you can open this door. If only this shame can be rolled away from my life. I prophesy to you this morning, by the word of God, that issue of shame shall be rolled away in the name of Jesus. He said, for it shall come to pass in that day, the burden shall be taken away from your shoulders and the yoke off your neck, and it shall be destroyed by reason of the anointing. Every satanic yoke that have been hanging around your life, that have been hanging in your generation, that have been hanging in your career, today, by the anointing, it shall be destroyed in the name of Jesus. What is exploit? Exploit is my birthright. What is exploit? Number one, exploit implies outstanding results. Outstanding results. Outstanding results. If you are a child of God, you are meant to be outstanding in every area of your life. And to be outstanding simply means to stand out. You are not on the same line with others. There is something in your life that is expected to bring you out, to stand out, to stand out. Until the result that is generated in your life catches the attention of people, it is not yet outstanding. After this anointing, God is giving you a result that will draw attention to you. That amen is not weak. That amen is too weak for a miracle. What is exploit? Number two, it means record-breaking accomplishment. Record-breaking accomplishment. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it come into the heart of man. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verses 9 and 10. The things that God has prepared for them that love him. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, record-breaking accomplishment. Things that have not been known to happen in your career, it will happen with you in the name of Jesus. The kind of result that has never been generated in that place of work where God has placed you, it will begin with you in the name of Jesus. The places that nobody has stepped in your family for good, you are stepping there after this service. In the name of Jesus. Record-breaking accomplishments. You are ordained for that level of exploits, that level of accomplishment. You are not ordained for normal results. Because you are supernatural. You are not normal. You are supernatural. You are not ordinary. You are extraordinary. He that cometh from above is above all. Matthew chapter 5 and verses 13 to 15. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. You are like a city that is set on a hill. Matthew 5, 13 to 15. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden. That cannot be hidden. Even if you want to hide, after this anointing, it will be impossible for you. I say it will be impossible for you. I say it will be impossible for you. This anointing will make you stand out. I said this anointing will make you stand out. After this service, the kind of result that will generate, it will bring tears of joy to your faces. It will bring tears of joy to your faces. In the name of Jesus. Record-breaking accomplishment. Look at the life of Isaac. In Genesis chapter 26 and verse 13, the Bible says, Genesis 26 and verse 13, and this man was great. We are not talking about another man. This man that everybody thought cannot succeed. This man that everybody has rejected. This man that everybody has given up on. This same man, he was great. He went forward. He grew until he became very great. I guess that is your description. I say, I guess that is your description. I guess that is your description. In the name of Jesus. Record-breaking accomplishment. What of Job? Job became the greatest in the East. Job chapter 1 and verse 3. He became the greatest. He became the greatest. Maybe in your family, nobody ever goes up. When they are about to go up, they bring them down. Not you. Not you. Not you. Not you. After this anointing, that yoke shall be destroyed in your family. That yoke shall be destroyed in your family. Maybe nobody has ever built any house in your family. Each time they are trying to build, they kill them. Maybe there was a building that your fathers have started 30 years ago up to now, yet uncompleted because of the works of wicked men. But I speak to you by the anointing of God today, that yoke shall be destroyed. That yoke shall be destroyed. That yoke shall be destroyed. He became the greatest man in the East. The greatest man in the East. That's exploits. That's the realm you belong to. And from the beginning of this year, it has been declared to the winner's family that giants shall rise. Giant in every field of life. That word has gone forth. It cannot return unto him void. No matter the position where you are now, it does not take God time. If you believe his word, if you believe his word, before this year is over, that testimony shall become a reality in your life. That testimony shall become a reality in your life. In the name of Jesus. Where you are is already tired of you. You are going forward. In Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse 3. Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse 3. Ye have compassed this mountain long enough. Turn, you not war. You have compassed this mountain enough. Turn, 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 turn. There is a force of the spirit that will forcefully change your position. Turn. You have compassed this mountain long enough. Long enough. The forces of hell have held you down long enough. The forces of barrenness has held you down long enough. The forces of stagnation has held you down long enough. Turn. That doesn't look like an admonishment. It looks like a commandment. Turn. Turn. It's not an advice. Turn. By the force of the spirit today, something is turning inside of you. Something is turning inside of you. Maybe they have tied down your destiny somewhere. They say you will not marry. They say you will not be promoted. They say you will not go forward. I speak by the spirit of God, by the unction back in this commission, that snare is destroyed. That snare is destroyed. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. God wants every area of your life to be a positive reference and not a reproach. God wants every area of your life to be a positive reference, not a reproach. He said, and men shall see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Men shall see your good works. You have spoken enough. They want to see the reality and give glory to your Father that is in heaven. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16. God wants every area of your life to be a positive reference. In Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 15, Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 15, whereas thou hast been forsaken and hated, so that no man went through thee, I will make thee an eternal excellency, a joy of many generations. Men may have mocked you, but God can make you. I will make you an eternal excellency. That word excellency is honorable. A joy of many generations. Maybe you have been a concern to your family. Maybe you have been a concern to people around you. And each time they see you coming, they shake their head. They shake their head. But not after this service. Not after this service. After this service, there's going to be a forceful turnaround. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In Revelation chapter 5 and verse 10, he has made us unto kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. We are expected to reign in any domain we are positioned in life. We are supposed to have continuous breakthroughs in every area of life. But unfortunately, many that are ordained to live as kings and priests, they are living as slaves. It's an error under the sun. It's an error under the sun. So that's why you need a superior force. Because you have been held captive, not by your own doing, not willingness, but the forces of hell is holding you down. That's why you need a force, a superior force from heaven. Many want to go forward. Many want to succeed, but they don't know the key. When you have the key, you don't struggle. When you have the key, you don't struggle. No matter how physically strong you are, if you don't have the key to a door, you will struggle. You will sweat. And only the one that has the key has control, has access. His weight notwithstanding. If you don't have the key, your weight, you can be big, you can be muscular, but the door will not respect you. But the one who has the key, it may just be a small boy. He just walks in with the key very quietly and opens without struggle. It is the key that gives you authority. It is the key that gives you dominion. It is the key that gives you access. When you have the key, no devil can resist you. When you have the key, you don't negotiate. When you have the key, you take control. Hallelujah. What is therefore the master key to a life of exploits? Matthew 22 verses 36 to 40. What is the master key to a life of exploit? Matthew 22 and verses 36 to 40. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Love is the master key to a life of exploits. Love. Love is the master key to a life of exploits. If you see a master key, it's not in the size. A master key is just a tiny instrument that has the ability to open any door, anytime, at will. When you have the master key, you have the power, you have the authority to take what you desire anytime. The master key, it opens any kind of door. That's why it is called master. It has dominion over every door. The moment you stretch out the key, the door will say, "I hear, sir," and open. That's why it's a master key. You use that key, barrenness will look at, as soon as barrenness sees the key, he says, "Sorry." You approach the door of promotion with that key. As soon as the door sees the key, and say, "Oh, sorry, we have been waiting for you." That's why it's a master key. It's a master of every situation and circumstances of life. Love is that master key. It may look small, but it is powerful. It is the love of God in the heart of man that throws him into a life of all-round exploits. Love. Love. The deeper your love for God is, the higher you rise in life. In Psalm 91 and verse 14. Psalm 91 and verse 14. "Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name." Because he has set his love upon me. Not upon things, not upon title, not upon persons, but he has set his love upon me. I am committed. I will set him on high above all. I will set him. He wouldn't need to beg me. He wouldn't need to ask me. Because he has set his love upon me, it's conditional. When you do it, it becomes automatic. The deeper your love for God, the higher you rise in life. It is your level of love, the intensity of your love for God, that determines the quality of your life. Not the economic situation. Not the situation and circumstances around you. No, it is your love for God. Your love for God. Your love for God. Your love for God. God can do anything for lovers. I have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has he come into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. 1 Corinthians 2:9. For them that love him. Not for everybody that comes to church. Not for everybody that has a sticker. Not for everybody that chants from glory to glory. For them that love him. For them that love him. Not for everyone that is in 2-3 units in the church. You can be full of activities and yet not love God. For them that love him. For them that love him. You can be high. You can be carrying a title and yet not love him. There is no entitlement in title. For them that love him. Do you love God? Your position in life is determined by your sincere answer to that question. Do you love God? Your heart is what God wants. He said, "My son, give me your heart." Proverbs 23 and verse 26. "Give me your heart. I need your heart. Your heart is divided. Give me your heart." It's either I am the Lord of all or I am the Lord of none. Give me all your heart. Give me all your heart. David became a darling of God. Why? Because he gave God all his heart. He was a man after God's heart. His heart was beating after the things that was beating in the heart of God. What is beating in your heart? Give me your heart. Give me your heart. And I will give you the earth. Give me your heart. And I will give you the earth. Give me your heart. And I will give you the heart. The position you give God in your heart is what determines the position he gives you on the earth. The position you give God in your heart is what determines the position he places you on the earth. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Seek ye first. What position is God in your heart? First or second or last? Give me your heart. Love is just more than singing. It's just more than jumping. No, it is a practical demonstration to the advancement of God's kingdom. God's servant, our father in faith, Bishop David Oyedepo said, you don't know my secret until you know my heart for God. That is where my secret is, my heart. Everything is sold out to God. I have no reservation. I don't feel for myself. Where is your heart? Your heart is what determines your path. You have prayed enough. Walk yourself into your testimony by a practical demonstration of love for God. Your heart is what determines your path. If your heart is there for God, nothing moves you. You are completely sold out. Nothing can stop you. If your heart is for God, nothing, no discouragement, nothing. Hear what Paul says in Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. He said, none of these things move me. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I've received of the Lord to testify the gospel of the grace of God. None of these things move me. When you see a Christian who is moved by every little thing, you see, I don't think I will come to church again. The way the usher treated me, they just took my Bible from that seat. They hold me. And that has affected your services to God. You don't love God. You have left that evangelism group. Why? Because of the way somebody spoke to you. It wasn't God you came to seek after. You came to seek for man. When you are moved by little things, small things, where you sit, who greets you, who didn't greet you, whether you are ordained or not, you see, I came to this church before those people they ordained. I don't know how they do this thing here. One of them was my convert. I preached to him. I followed him up. And now they say he's a deacon. Me, they left me. Okay, they won't see me. They don't understand my value. They don't know the anointing I carry. Paul said, none of these things move me. None of these things move me. You came for evangelism, and suddenly your car broke down. And since then, your zeal for God has dwindled. Who gave you the car? Thank God, is it not God that didn't allow your life to break down? None of these things move me. I count my life as nothing. In Romans chapter 5 and verses 35 to 38. Romans chapter 8 verses 35 to 38. Romans 8, 35 to 38. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor power, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Hallelujah. If you check men of exploit in scriptures, this was their fundamental secret, the love for God. David, a lover of God, in 1 Samuel chapter 13 and verse 14. He was a man after God's heart. 1 Samuel 13, 14. Job was a man that feared God. The things of God mattered to him. So he became the greatest man in the East. Job chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. Job 1, verses 1 to 3. Daniel was a man that loved God. He would not defile himself. In Daniel chapter 1 and verse 8, with the king's meal, he refused, I'm not going to defile myself. He stood for God. He loved God. And we saw how he was lifted in the land. Paul was a lover of God. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21. He said, for me to live is Christ. To die is gain. He was sold out. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless I live, yet not I. The life I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Love was their fundamental secret. And we saw all the exploit they generated. You too will generate exploit in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. What is in the power? What is the power of love? Let's look at the power of love. Number one, what power is in love? Number one, love is failure proof. It's a failure proof force. It's a failure proof force. You don't fail loving God. You don't fail loving God, because God, there is no failure in God. And if you are in God, you are in love. When you are in love, you are in God. God is not a failure. You cannot fail. Love cannot fail. Faith can fail. Prayer may fail, but love will never fail. God is not looking for the strong. He's only looking for the faithful. So faithfully go after him. And every door that you expect to open will open in your life. Hallelujah. Love is failure proof force. Every other thing may fail. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 8. Every other thing may fail, but love can never fail. Charity never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. Any other thing can fail, but love can never fail, because God is love. He that loves is in God, and God is in him. Number two, love engenders supernatural breakthroughs. Love engenders supernatural breakthroughs. In Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verses 1 to 2. Deuteronomy 28 and verses 1 to 2. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord your God, to observe and to do all his commandments which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all the nations of the earth. Above all. Love takes people above. It doesn't take people down. Love takes people forward. It doesn't take people backward. If you will hearken diligently, if you will seek God, if you will run after God with your whole heart, he said, I will set you above. I will open every closed doors. So love engenders supernatural breakthrough. And number three, love makes all true lovers of Christ indestructible. It makes all true lovers of Christ indestructible. Indestructible. You can't be touched. You can't be killed. You can't be harmed. Hallelujah. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, the Bible says, you are of God, little children, and overcome them. Why? Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So if you are in love with God, God resides in you. Whatever cannot touch God cannot touch you. Whatever cannot harm God cannot harm you. No satanic arrow of the devil can touch God. Your life is hid in Christ and Christ in God. So if you walk in love, if you love God, you are shielded, you are protected. They threw those three Hebrew brothers into fire. They couldn't burn. Why? Because God was there with them, the fourth man. So when you are living a life of love for God, anywhere you go, you carry God. God's presence goes with you everywhere. God's presence go with you everywhere. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He anointed me even in the presence of my enemies. My cup runneth over. They were helpless. So when you are walking in love, your enemies become helpless. You can't stop them from planning. You can't stop them from gathering. The Bible says, surely they shall gather. You can't stop them even from taking counsel. They will take counsel. But he said, their counsel will be nothing. I will destroy their counsel. I will destroy. I will break their plans. So when you walk in love, you are shielded. No devil can touch you. What are the biblical proofs of love? How do I know I love God? How do I know I love God? If you love God, you will give to his cause. If you love God, you will give. You will give. You will give. You will give. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. If you love God, you will give. If you love God, the grace to give becomes easy. You give easily to the advancement of God's kingdom. True love is demonstrated by giving. It's demonstrated by giving. Everyone in scripture that love God, they prove they love God by giving. Solomon loved the Lord and he gave. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3. David loved the Lord. He gave because I've set my affection on God. He demonstrated it by giving qualitatively. He demonstrated it by giving qualitatively unto the Lord. If you love God, you will give. True lovers are givers. True lovers are givers. And that's why when you see a man who has just located somebody to marry, the love is turning him from head to toe. Nothing can stop him to demonstrate his love. He has gone to visit his wife-to-be. And the only money he had in his pocket is the one to transport him back. As he gets there after talking and talking, and she's escorting him, and suddenly the sister says, "Oh, I like some ice cream." He says, "Okay, ice cream, no problem." She takes the first one. The transport money has reduced. The sister says, "And I like the other one, the brown one." She takes again. The money keeps reducing until the money finishes. It's not disturbed. You can just feel free. Take it. No problem. He will even ask more, "Do you want more?" And be praying silently, "Oh God, let her say no." And as soon as the sister leaves him and is going from Goshen, maybe to Asokoro. So as soon as the sister leaves him, he's excited, he has given to his lover. So he rolls his trousers and says, "Lord, thank you for strength." And begins to march on. Why? Because he met his lover. If you love God, you will give. You will give. Praise the name of the Lord. You will give. Number two, if you love God, you will love his house. If you love God, you will love his house. Psalm 122, verses 1 to 6. "I was glad when they said unto me," David said, "let us go into the house of the Lord." I was glad. Coming to a church will be delight for you. You won't grumble. You won't murmur. You won't murmur. If you love God, you will love his house. You will be desiring every service, every program. You will be desiring. You will want to be in his presence. Why? Because Zion is the dwelling place of God. Why must you love Zion? It's the dwelling place of God. God resides there. God stays there. That is his habitation. In Psalm 132 and verses 13 to 14. "For the Lord has chosen Zion." Psalm 132 verses 13 and 14. "For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his habitation. This is my rest forever. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless her provision. I will satisfy her poor with bread. I will also clothe her priests with salvation, and her saints shall shout aloud with joy." Zion is God's habitation. And there is no safer place than where God dwells. There is no safer place than where God dwells. He said, "I will clothe her. I will satisfy her." That's the place of your satisfaction. There is nothing that you desire that is not in Zion. There is nothing you desire that is not in Zion. So we don't come to church just to fulfill all righteousness. We don't just come to church. Church is not a social place. Church is a spiritual place. It's a place of encounter with the living God. Where God satisfies your need. Instead of looking unto man to meet your need, look unto God. So in Zion, that is where God satisfies your needs. That's why you have countless testimonies. People say, "As I started coming to the church, suddenly this door opened. As I started coming to the church, this affliction of my life, my long-standing affliction, vanished." That is where God dwells. And no evil is permitted to dwell there. Praise the name of the Lord. No evil is permitted to dwell there. You remember that leper by the beautiful gate? Peter and John got there. They say, "What is this ugly situation doing at the feet of the beautiful gate?" Say, "Arise, you are not permitted. Everything here in Zion is beautiful. Your situation will not remain in the name of Jesus." It is the dwelling place of God. It is a place of strength. Psalm 84 verse 7. "They go from strength to strength, as many that are in Zion." Psalm 84 and verse 7. "They go from strength to strength, as many that appeared before God in Zion." So Zion is a place of strength. People who come to church regularly, they never get weak. It's a place of strength. It's a place of strength. It's a place of strength. Zion is a place of deliverance. Obadiah 1 and verse 17. Upon Mount Zion there shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness, and the sons of Jacob shall possess their possession. It's a place of deliverance. It's a place of deliverance. That is, I said, with the issue of blood, all these years I've been carrying that plague, but they told me, 3 months, if you still have this plague, don't come to church. She said, for many years, you say 3 months, okay, let's go. She came and God visited her. Why? Because it is a place of deliverance. It is a place of deliverance. Do you have some affliction in your life that have defied all kinds of solutions? Stay in Zion. Satan will fight by all means to take you out of Zion because he wants to stop your miracle. He knows when he takes you out of your covering zone, he has right to afflict you. Just like that prodigal son. Until he left his father's house, Satan could not touch him. Stay! Because Zion is a place of deliverance. And lastly, it is a place where you possess your possession. Where you possess your possession. Whatever it is that Jesus has paid the price with his blood is available. You possess it in Zion. You possess it in Zion. You possess it in Zion. And thank God you are in Zion this morning. Thank God it's an anointing service. In Isaiah chapter 10 and verse 27, it shall come to pass in that day. The burden shall be taken away from your shoulders. All the problem, the challenges, and the yoke from your neck. And it shall be dissolved by reason of the anointing. Whatever plague, whatever challenge that you came therefore with this morning, it shall be destroyed. In the name of Jesus, may the Lord give you understanding. In Jesus' mighty name. Just before we rise up to pray, one major requirement for your liberty today is you must be born again. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 3, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great way of salvation? How will you escape from that struggle? How will you escape from that trap of satanic manipulation? How will you escape from that spirit of death that have been roving over your family? If you say no to Jesus today, you have said no to life. If you say no to Jesus today, you have said yes to afflictions and sorrows. But I know somebody will say yes to Jesus today. Maybe you gave your life to Jesus before you backslided. Today, his hands are wide open. He can receive you and your life will never be the same. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I know as I'm speaking now, somebody is saying, I need to give my life to Jesus now. I know something has gone wrong in my life. This way I'm living, I am not sure of eternity. This way I'm going, I live in fear. But Jesus is here today. I want to introduce you to that Jesus. If you will only say yes, things will change. Things will turn around. Maybe you gave your life before, you backslided. Because you are pursuing after job. You are pursuing after marriage. Satan took you. And since then, things have been going down. You can return today. And he will accept you. I know somebody is ready to do that. Now, wherever you are, you want to say yes to Jesus. I'd like you to rise up on your feet wherever you are. Rise up on your feet wherever you are. I know as I'm speaking now, something is telling you, it is me. It is me. It is me. The Spirit of God is convicting your heart. Forget about your neighbor. Rise up on your feet. Take that bold step. Today is a day of turnaround. Wherever you are giving your life to Jesus, or maybe you are rededicating your life to Jesus. Rise up on your feet. You know you are very zealous for God before, but you backslided. You can return to Jesus. Rise up and join them. Rise up and join them. No matter how far you have gone, you can return to Jesus. No matter how far you have gone, you can return to Jesus. Rise up. All those rising up, please, can I ask you to take your Bible and come forward, whatever you came with, come forward. God bless you. Come forward quickly. Quickly, wherever you are, come forward. If I were you, I would start running from where I am. The faster you get to the front, the faster your miracle arrives. Come quickly. Come quickly. God bless you. Come quickly from wherever you are. Don't say no to him this morning. Don't say no to him this morning. That's where your salvation is. That's where your healing is. That's where your deliverance is. Let's celebrate them, church. Come quickly. Come quickly. Wherever you are, don't say no to Jesus. To reject him is to reject life. Wherever you are, come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. God bless you. Come quickly. God bless you. Come quickly. We are waiting for you. I know there are some people that are seated there. You are still saying, should I go? Should I not go? That's the devil making you to think that way. Break that yoke. Rise up from your feet and begin to come forward. God bless you. Come quickly. Come quickly. Please join us quickly, all those in front. I'd like to congratulate you for this step you have taken. Every one of us took this step one day. And since we took this step, our lives never remained the same. This seemingly simple step you have taken today is going to bring a holistic turnaround in every area of your life. In the name of Jesus. Not just giving your life to Jesus. Stay in Zion. Stay in Zion. You heard the testimony of that sister. They say stay 3 months and you will see God's visitation. If you can stay 3 months consistently hearing God's word and taking practical steps of obedience, you must have your testimony in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I'd like you to bow your head. Bow your head. Bow your head. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you this morning. I realize I'm a sinner, but you died for me. You took away my sin. You redeem me with your blood. My heart is open this morning. I believe in my heart, Jesus. And I confess you with my mouth. Be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for receiving me. Because I've confessed you, I know I am born again. Thank you for receiving me. In Jesus' mighty name. Father, thank you for these precious souls that you have redeemed this day. No one comes to you except you draw them. You have drawn them, preserved them, keep them. Let none of them be lost. In the name